the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. You are holy. Holy are you, Lord God Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the thank you.
Good morning, San Marcos. It's so good to be with you. We continue to, Lord willing, come into your homes via the magic of the internet and social media. It is not the same as being together. Being here physically in the Cristo Mi Pastor church building reminds me of how much I long to be back with all of you, to see you face to face, to share with you, to share from the Lord's table. And we wait with longing hearts for that moment. And we pray that we would continue to see advance, progress, and breakthrough in this whole process with coronavirus, with COVID-19. But we continue to pray for all of you. We continue to have a weekly prayer meeting, a weekly fellowship meeting, besides the fellowship meeting that meets after the service. Sundays at 11, we also have a fellowship meeting Thursdays at 5:30. You're welcome to that. You're welcome to our prayer meeting Tuesdays at 9 p.m. So important for you to plug in. If you would like to be plugged into something, but none of those time slots works for you, please don't be passive. Come and let us know if there's something you'd like to do or be involved with or lead, and we'll see what we can do so that we can have more opportunities for growth and fellowship as a church during these times with so much restrictions with this lockdown. Please continue to give towards San Marcos. And I say this as someone who's transitioning out of the ministry here in this church, out of this country, but this church and this ministry must go on in reaching the expat community with the gospel, whoever comes along, whatever the leadership team will be in the next few months and years. And your giving toward the ministry of the church is key for San Marcos continuing to be, by God's grace, a beacon of gospel light in this city. So please don't forget to give. If you have any questions, speak to me, speak to San Mateer, speak to Gilbert, speak to Christian Moreno, send us a WhatsApp, call us, email us, but don't be passive. Continue your commitment in those ways. Let's dive into God's word this morning, and I want us especially to keep an eye on 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. We will continue on from where we were last week, but I would like for us to stop and just look briefly at a phrase in 1 Thessalonians 2, which I think is so important. And I think that it is worth looking at that. Our next two talks, next two expositions from the scripture, will be a little shorter than the ones that we've had so far, but hopefully we will be able to go a little deeper on and into some themes. I want just to read the first four verses of 1 Thessalonians 2, because I want to go back and just highlight one phrase that I want us to consider this morning. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 1 to 4, and really we're going to look at the end of verse 4. Sorry, chapter 2, verses 1 to 4. We're going to look at the end of verse 4, which I think is very important. Paul writes, and he says, "For you yourselves know, brothers, that our coming to you was not in vain. But though we had already suffered and had been shamefully treated at Philippi, as you know, we had boldness in our God to declare to you the gospel of God in the midst of much conflict. For our appeal does not spring from error or impurity or any attempt to deceive, but just as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel, so we speak, not to please man, but to please God who tests our hearts." I want us to consider that phrase in 1 Thessalonians, where Paul describes the God that he has come to know, to love, to serve, as the God who tests our hearts. And I want to speak about the testing of our hearts this morning. Let's pray and ask God to help us understand his word and to equip us and fill us with himself by his spirit to live this word out in our lives. Let's pray. Almighty God, I pray that you would help me to be faithful in teaching your word. And I pray, Almighty God, that by the Holy Spirit that you have poured out on your church since Pentecost, I pray that you would fill each and every one of us to hear your word, to receive it, to be transformed by it, and to put it into practice. I pray that your word would encourage, comfort, and challenge our hearts, and that it would mold us, that you would mold us to live and in light of these precious truths. I ask I ask you, Father, that you would do this in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to draw our attention to this theme, this idea. God here is described as the God who tests our hearts. And the first thing to say right off the bat is he's not speaking of temptation. In James chapter 1, this letter written by the brother of Jesus, in James chapter 1, James is very clear, and he says, God does not tempt us. He does not tempt us to sin. Rather, temptation to sin comes from within our own broken souls, as it were, through our sinful nature, and obviously through the work of the enemy in the world, of Satan. God does not tempt us to sin. So that's not what Paul here is describing. Rather, Paul is speaking of the fact that God will often allow us to be exposed to circumstances that put our conviction to the test, in which our hearts are tested. We see this in many places in the Bible, but we see this especially and incredibly in the life, for example, of Abraham, who is described as the father of the faith, the father even of New Covenant faith, of the gospel faith. Abraham, we find him in Genesis 12, and God comes to him. God chooses him. Abraham is not a great guy, not an exceptional guy in of himself, but God comes into his life to make him an exceptional person. And God speaks to him in Genesis 12. And in Genesis 12, God pours out these amazing promises over Abraham. He speaks these promises to Abraham, and he says to Abraham, Abraham, I will have you, I will bring out of you a descendant. I will bring out of you descendants, a seed, a line of people who will become a nation through whom I will bring blessing into this world. I will bring salvation from condemnation, salvation from eternity separated from myself. I will bring real joy, purpose, and hope into this world, renewal and restoration into this world. And I'm going to do it through people who come from you and through you, you and your wife, Sarah. And Abraham and Sarah are old. They apparently cannot have children. And yet God makes this promise to Abraham. And we learn in Genesis 15 that Abraham believes this promise. He's declared righteous by God. And then there are a series of trials that come into Abraham's life, Abraham and Sarah's life. But God ultimately fulfills his promise by allowing Abraham and Sarah to have a child, Isaac. And Isaac begins to grow up, and things seem to be going really well. And Abraham is excited and encouraged. And yet, in chapter 22 of Genesis 22, we read that God speaks to Abraham. And God says to Abraham in Genesis 22, verse 2, take your son, God says, your only son, he emphasizes, your only son, your precious son, the son that you love, even though actually Abraham had another son. But there was a unique place, obviously, when it came to Isaac. He was the son of the promise. And he says, take your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love, emphasizing again, the son that has your heart. And God says, and go to the land of Moriah, go to the mount, basically, and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I shall tell you. This seems to contradict everything that God had told Abraham. God had told him, I'm going to give you a son, and through your son I will bring this blessing. Oh, now I need you to take that son and kill him, to offer him as a burnt sacrifice, an offering. And Abraham goes. Abraham moves. And at one point in verse 7, Isaac, who's going with him, notices, wait, where's the animal to be sacrificed? Where's the animal that we should be sacrificing if we're going to worship God? There's nothing. And he says in Genesis 22, verse 7, Isaac said to his father, Abraham, my father. And he, Abraham, said, here I am, my son. And Isaac said, behold, the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering? Verse 8, Abraham said, God will provide for himself the lamb for a burnt offering, my son. So they both went together. This is so precious because it shows us where Abraham's faith was. Abraham had received this promise. Abraham had believed this promise. This promise had come into fruition in the person of Isaac. Then God says, kill Isaac. And as Abraham is walking towards the place where he's supposed to offer Isaac, and he's questioned about what is he going to offer to sacrifice, we see that Abraham believes that God is going to provide the sacrifice. And it will not be Isaac. It will be a lamb. Abraham's heart is being tested. Do you really trust in the promise that God himself gave to you? Where is your heart? Where is your trust? And where ultimately is your love, Abraham? And then we keep reading. Abraham is ready to offer up his son as a sacrifice. And at the last moment, God intervenes. And God says in Genesis 22, verse 12, do not lay your hand on the boy or do anything to him, for now I know that you fear God, seeing that you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me. I am number one in your life. So much so, Abraham, that even that which is most precious to you, your beloved son that you consider your only, you are willing to give him to me, says God. But here's the interesting thing. We read in other places in the Bible, for example, in the Old Testament, Psalm 44 or 21, that God knows the secrets of the heart. Or in Hebrews 4:13, God is described as the one before whom no creature is hidden from his sight. Everyone is exposed before him. And so when God here says, now I know, we realize that there is a bit of a rhetorical term. There's a rhetorical situation going on because God knows Abraham's heart. So when God tests our hearts, God isn't trying to fish for more information. He's not trying to get information that he doesn't have. But rather, he is putting us in a situation where he can reveal our hearts principally not to him, but to ourselves. Tests are moments where our hearts are exposed to ourselves, where we can see ourselves truly as who we are. We are so good at deceiving even ourselves, but moments where our hearts are tested show us where we really are, where our confidence really is, who or what we really and truly ultimately love. And Abraham passes the test. He's not a perfect, sinless man, but his heart is wholly devoted to God. When God tests us, when God tests our hearts, it is not to destroy us. It is not to humiliate us. It is not to lay some sort of punishment on us, but rather it is to lead us and to move us into a deeper place of confidence, trust, and total devotion and surrender to God. Because at the same time that Abraham trusts God, he's having to take steps towards that place of death and of sacrifice. And his faith is being stretched and matured, and his faith is being cultivated and growing and strengthening through the process of being tested. In fact, James, going back to James chapter 1, James says that testing produces in us steadfastness, perseverance, maturity. And Peter in 1 Peter speaks in a similar way in 1 Peter and 2 Peter as well, of how, but he speaks in 1 Peter 1 about how the experience of testing and trial purifies, strengthens our faith and our devotion to God. But part of what happens as well is God leads us into deepening and ever deepening knowledge of who he is. He reveals himself evermore to us. He reveals his character to us with ever more clarity. He reveals to greater depth the gospel itself. Did you notice that in Genesis 22, when Abraham is asked about the lack of an animal for sacrifice, Abraham says, God, verse 8, God will provide for himself the lamb for a burnt offering. But when God provides, and in fact, Abraham calls that place, right? He names the place the Lord will provide, verse 14. When God actually provides, verse 13, Abraham lifts up his eyes and looked, and behold, behind him was a ram caught in the thicket by his horns. There's a ram that's provided, not a lamb. Now, we can read over that detail and think, well, you know, Abraham expected a lamb, but it was just a ram. No. But Abraham had said, God will provide the lamb. In the moment, God provides a ram, and we're left to ask ourselves, is there something more to the words of Abraham when he says to Isaac, God himself will provide, God will provide for himself a lamb? And those words echo through the Bible, echo through from Genesis on through the Old Testament. God himself will provide the lamb. And it's so important because Abraham is considered in the New Testament by Paul himself as the father of the faith, the father of New Testament faith, the father of gospel faith. God will provide a ram, says Abraham, and his words echo in through the Old Testament until we arrive at the story of John the Baptist in John 1. And in John chapter 1, the Gospel of John chapter 1, John the Baptist, the prophet, turns around and points to Jesus and says, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. It is the Lamb that comes from God, the Lamb that God has provided to stand in our place, to die in our place as a sacrifice. God relinquishes Abraham of having to provide his own beloved son as a sacrifice, and God to redeem Abraham, God to redeem each and every one of us, to provide salvation for all the world. God, as Father, gives up his beloved Son for us. The Lamb that God will provide is actually going to be God's Son in substitution for Isaac. God's Son in substitution for me. God's Son in substitution for you. The gospel being revealed even in Abraham's time. Even in Abraham's time. God tests our hearts. And when God tests our hearts, again, it's not out of cruelty, but rather it is a roadmap. It is an opportunity. It is a fork in the road in our walk with him to move forward in faith and trust in the promises of God, despite the circumstances, screaming at us that God is unfaithful, unkind. We walk forward trusting in God and his promises. And as we do so, we experience God unveiling with greater clarity who he is, unveiling with greater clarity his own heart, unveiling his Son. His Son who is the perfect revelation of the Father. The Son who came in pure righteousness, who came in perfect faithfulness to the Father. The Son who came to love and was rejected by this world and died on the cross as a sacrifice for our sins. And was risen on the third day, raised in resurrection, new life, and ascended and established as King and Savior, and calls upon us to turn to him and trust in him. That is the heart of the Father. And God's heart is revealed to us in times of testing. God is testing our hearts and tests our hearts that we may know him more truly and deeply. So if during this time you are being tested, I pray and I ask you this very morning to not resent God for that experience of testing, to not reject that experience of testing, but to receive with gratitude the testing of your heart and ask God this morning, God, help me. Show me who I really am and help me to more fully and truly and deeply trust you and love you and reveal yourself more beautifully and deeply to me. God wants to unveil himself more to you through this experience. And the question will be if you will have the heart that Abraham had, if you will have the eyes of faith that Abraham had to receive that testing with joy and to experience his perfect work in our hearts as he tests our hearts. Let's pray. Almighty God, I pray that you would do something precious, deep, and lasting in our hearts. That this time of testing, which is a time of testing for so many of us, would be a time in which we are not simply left defeated, disillusioned, disappointed, discouraged, but rather a time in which we step forward and walk with you and trust you and interact with you and plead with you in prayer, that we might experience the blessing of knowing you truly and more deeply, and that in so doing we may know how beautiful and wonderful you truly and really are, and that our love, our devotion, and our trust in you would grow as a result. Father, in the name of Jesus, by the Holy Spirit, do this work in our life. We pray. Amen. Friends, see you next week. Bye-bye.
Let the King of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from, oh, he is my song. Let the King of my heart be the shelter where I hide, the ransom for my life, oh, he is my song. You are good, good, oh, you are good, good, oh. Let the King of my heart be the wind inside my sails, the echo in the waves, oh, he is my the King of my heart, be the fire inside of my veins, the echo of my days, oh, he is my song. You are good, you're good, oh, you are good, you're good, oh.
Never gonna let me down.